Bobby, what a great way to start a new year with news that just keeps getting weirder and weirder. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. You know, this first story.
Well, it's going to be a good year. Let's say that.
I think it is.
It's going to be a hard year for America because we got the economy in the tank, and we've got a lot of people suffering around the country, and we've got our military personnel coming back injured and maimed from Iraq, but hopefully we'll see the end of these wars. And we have a president in office now who I think shares a vision of the United States that's consistent with the idealism and the nobility and that our country has for many years represented in its role as an exemplary nation. So we have the leadership we need. We're at the bottom of the hole, hopefully, but we've got the leadership we need to claw our way back out.
Well, that's what everybody's waiting for, and we're all anticipating that exactly what you said is going to happen. Look, let's start with his first story. First thing that he needs to pay attention to along with the bad news. Yeah, along with everything else. I mean, you know, it is kind of a shame that the things we have to talk about are things that we really have to talk about because they don't hear these stories anywhere else. How about this? The Arctic melt passes the point of no return. You saw that story.
For many years, scientists have warned that there are tipping points in our path to global warming because of what they call feedback mechanisms, that actually as the world gets warmer, there are contributing mechanisms. For example, the melting of the permafrost, which will add huge amounts of methane to the atmosphere, which will compound and amplify global warming enormously.
And it adds methane because why? Explain that a little bit.
Well, basically, there's a large part of the Earth that is tundra, that is frozen peat. And when that peat unthaws, the carbon is locked. There's huge amounts of methane that are locked in that peat, which are, you know, the rotting gases. Or gas produced by rotting organic material. When that material is not rotting now because it's frozen, but when we warm the globe, the permafrost disappears. It's no longer frozen, and huge amounts of the terrestrial surface of the Earth suddenly begin producing giant amounts of methane gas. That's one of the feedback mechanisms. Another one is that as the North Pole melts, the white reflective surface of the snow, which reflects heat back into the atmosphere, is replaced by the dark surface of the ocean, which actually absorbs more heat. When that tipping point is reached, some scientists believe it will be too late to do anything about global warming because the warming will take on a life of its own. And some scientists now say that that tipping point was triggered this year.
Thing called Arctic amplification. I've heard you use the term before. The crazy thing is, Bobby, we were talking about this 5 years ago, one of our first programs, and you were talking about the point that that's where it's going to happen. We're going to see it with the Arctic Sea. We're going to see the accumulation of heat in the ocean. This Arctic amplification is going to take place.
If you remember Al Gore's movie, he says we have 10 years to solve the problem. That wasn't an arbitrary number. That was the number that was taken from the computer models that said 10 years from now, 10 to 15 years from now, you're going to see so much Arctic ice melted that we're going to get this new feedback mechanism that it's going to make it almost impossible to reverse the impacts of global warming. Well, what's happened is that that reality has outpaced the model by 5 years, so that we are now seeing this happening. And they know this because they measure the air temperature on the ground right above the ice. And they know from that the feedback mechanism, which is the absorption of heat by the ocean, dark open ocean surface, is actually contributing huge amounts of heat to ground level heat to the Arctic.
So the Earth is melting. Obama's coming into office having to pay attention to these other meltdowns, economic, military, just in every kind of meltdown you can imagine that the little buffoon has left him. And this is something that's so important that, as a matter of fact, James Hansen, you've talked about Hansen before, with NASA, NASA scientist,
sends we've a, had him on the show many times.
Yeah, he sends a letter to Obama where it's really a heartfelt letter. He says it's a personal plea from he and his wife to write you as a fellow parent concerned about the earth and what our children, our grandchildren are going to inherit and those that aren't yet, that are yet to be born. This is he was so concerned that he says, look, I know you have all these things that you have to do, but here's what you must do for this next generation. So he says the three things that he wants to do. What is it? Moratorium, first of all.
On all new coal plants and a phase out of current plants that is very, very quick.
Is that doable, Bobby?
Politically, I think it's a heavy lift. Unless, you know, the government does a major job, which I think it ought to do, to counteract the huge propaganda campaign that was sponsored by Exxon and Southern Company and Chevron and Massey to persuade the public that global warming is not a problem. Hmm. We need to start educating the public and showing them what's really happening and that we're facing a catastrophe much worse than terrorism, which the Pentagon itself has said that this is the greatest threat to human civilization.
Okay, so the first thing you said, need a moratorium. You need phase out coal-fired plant, tough thing to do. Second, he talks about you need a carbon tax.
With 100% dividend, which is not a tax. You would tax the use of carbon and then not keep the money. The government wouldn't keep the money, but it would redistribute the money evenly to every American so that those who used carbon would get a huge disadvantage and those who didn't use or use less carbon would collect the dividend without having to pay anything, and that would reward people who use less carbon and tax people who use more. It's a novel idea, but it's one that is interesting.
Yeah. Well, James Hansen, again, when I read this is a plea. This is a guy that probably knows more about this problem than anybody in the world, and he's pleading with Obama. And the next thing he says, okay, you need a moratorium, you need the carbon tax, 100% dividend, and then you need to engage in research of fourth generation nuclear plants. I mean,
that's what he says. I'm more optimistic than he is about the capacity of current technology for renewables to do the job much cheaper, much more efficiently, and far quicker than nuclear power plants. We have the ability now. 18% of the desert Southwest in this country, an area 85 miles by 85 miles could power, if you had solar thermal plants there, the entire nation, all the electrical needs of our country. We have enough wind power just in Montana, North Dakota, and Texas. That's the Saudi Arabia of wind, the American Midwest, to provide 100% of the energy needs of our country. I don't think we really need to go to do new research. We have off-the-shelf technology right now. All we need to do, really, Mike, is to create a marketplace that's able where every American can become an energy entrepreneur, every home can become a power plant. But we don't have a national grid that can carry that energy or that is accessible to the public. And that's what Obama really needs to do.
Okay, let's take a quick break. Let's take a break, come back to some non-environmental topics. There's just so much news out there. It's like a banner week of weird news. We'll be right back.